March 17th at 10 o'clock at the Avonmore Building, Larry Walker is going to teach on Dutch oven cooking. Anybody's welcome to go there if they would like to.
What time, please?
10 o'clock?
Yeah.
Yes. Reminder about the communication drill on the 31st. On April 14th, our next lecture will be family emergency plans. And Larry, would you like to introduce your guest? We'll get started.
When we were going through our list of things that we wanted to teach, I noticed that one of them was wound care, and immediately I thought of Stan Phillips. Not only is he a physician that deals with wounds on a daily basis, but he was a missionary down in Haiti. And when they had their earthquake down there, he and some of his fellow physicians went down there and spent a couple of weeks treating the wounded and helping out down there in the aftermath of that earthquake. And so as I thought about this, I thought he'd be the ideal person to give us some information on what to do in a disaster situation as far as taking care of wounds. So he has 18 years of experience as a podiatrist, and I've been under his caring hands myself and my family, so I appreciate him for that. Dr. Phillips.
So, physicians, we're not supposed to get sick. I apologize. I have a cold and feeling kind of miserable, actually, so I'll do my best to get through this. I might have to take a couple breaks here to take a sip of water. So, you know, a couple things. First of all, disclaimer, some of the pictures you're going to see are a little graphic. So if you've got a weak stomach, you might just want to look away. I took out a lot of the real graphic ones. The other thing, this slide presentation originally was set up to as a presentation we give to the home health nurses to kind of help them understand where we as physicians, where we're coming from. So some of this might be a little, you know, maybe over your head, but I've tried to simple it. The first part's really simple because it talks about Haiti. And that's the first thing I want to talk about because this is emergency preparedness. And I was in an actual situation where there was a natural disaster and thousands of people were, you know, were affected by that. And I learned a lot from that. And so there's some just basic things that we'll go over. If something like that were to happen here, it's very, very possible, something, you know, like an earthquake. I'm almost 50, and I've been told for all those 50 years that we've got a big one coming within the next 50 years. So, you know, if we have one, yes, we have a lot of hospitals, we have a lot of facilities, but you know, there's limited space, if you think about it. If there were thousands of people that needed acute care, we need to be prepared to take care of our loved ones, and there's some simple things that we can take from today that you can do at home. So, you know, so why me? Again, in 2010, I more or less got a call. It wasn't a call directly from the Lord, but I serve my mission in Haiti. I speak the language. I have a set of skills. You know, I do wound care. I take care of fractures, and this would be an obvious thing for me to go down there. And it was amazing how it all worked out. I didn't have a passport, but with the help of one of our representatives, I got a passport within the day. It was just incredible the way things worked out so that I could go down to Haiti. These are some pictures we took from the helicopter going in. You can see the National Palace. And you see, these homes are just completely fast. So what kind of injuries do you think we're going to be dealing with?
Crush injuries.
Crush. Yeah, it's all crush injuries. And so, we'll say again, this might be a little graphic, some of the pictures that you'll see. And then this is the church in Laogon is where I went. That's a small town south of Port Prince. And this is the church, and you can see many of the members and other friends and family were camping out on the, in, the church, in the church courtyard. So, just a brief history on wound care. I'm not going to go into this a lot, but you know, wound care is something, you know, in the ancient times, people would gather in their area, there's certain trees or roots or something. You've heard about it. I had a patient one time, he said, look at my thumb. And I was like, okay. He's like, that thing was cut all the way off. My grandpa took pine gum and stuck it on there and look at it. It's perfectly fine. You know, and I'm like, all right, yeah, cool, you know, pine gum. So I've heard a lot of different stories. There's something in the early 40s, 50s, some back, or it was like a red stuff.
Huh?
Yeah. And people swear by that stuff. It's outlawed now because of the mercury, but I hear a lot of different things. But the one thing the Greeks, they found that there are acute wounds, okay, you get a cut. There's one way to manage that, and then there are chronic wounds, and we have different things that we need to do for chronic wounds. And we'll talk about that a little bit. One thing that's interesting is the Egyptians, they had a concoction, they would use lint, because the lint would absorb, and then they'd put grease over that to provide a moist barrier, and then honey, because of the high sugar content, actually is very antimicrobial, so it keeps out the bacteria. And then Johnson & Johnson, where did Johnson & Johnson come from? Anybody know what that was about? It was Harold Brown, I think it was Harold Brown Johnson. He was the first to sterilize gauze. Okay, there was a gentleman before him that had treated his bandages with phenol, and his infection rate went down 45%. And then Johnson & Johnson, Johnson's half of the Johnson. Sorry. They found that sterile gauze really helped in combating infection and open wounds. And then we know we have the age of the antibiotics, and that has been very, you know, penicillin came along, and that has really helped us in our battle with wounds. And then we'll talk about some of these other things. Negative pressure. Does anybody know what negative pressure is? I'll see if any of you had any wound care experience if you know what negative pressure is. Have you heard of wound vacs? A wound vacuum? Okay. That, in 18 years I've been in practice, the first probably 8 years, wound vacs were very, we just didn't use them a lot. It was hard to get a seal, and we lost a lot more. Patients of mine lost a lot more of their toes and feet and legs. But since the wound vacs are amazing, I saved so many more. Limb salvages are just very beneficial now. I've been able to save a lot of people from ending up with a below-knee amputation because of wound vacs. Obviously, we didn't have wound vacs in Haiti. So this is the ward there in Laogon. On Sunday, everybody got up, you know. They just had a disaster. And look at them. They got their shirts. They're out with their little irons that they put the charcoal in to heat it up. And they're pressing their white shirts. And it was amazing.
So what is a wound vac?
So it's essentially a vacuum. It's a little portable device. It has a tube. And so you put it over the wound with some foam, and you drape it so air can't get in, and then it constantly puts negative pressure. So the thing that
sucking infection out?
Yeah, so if you have a wound that's really producing a lot of pus, it'll pull that out. But also, negative pressure, the theory with negative pressure is it's pulling the nutrients and the blood flow out to the wound bed. And I'll show you some pictures at the end of what a leg, one of the legs we took care of, and how fast it did once we got the wound back going.
Is this something that we can get?
Nope. you have to come to the wound clinic. You have to have a wound, and you come to the wound clinic, and they are very expensive. I wish 18 years ago I would have invested $10,000, because then I could just go around and do this kind of stuff every month. I could go do disaster or community service, because yeah, it's quite the racket, the wound care, but that's a whole different topic. So, you know, these are simple little things. We see this, right? This isn't something you're going to see in a natural disaster, but simple wounds, you get a little cut like that, and it's better within a week or two. In someone that has a normal functioning immune system, adequate blood flow, these things heal up really quick. It's minor little things. Now, there are factors that affect wound healing, and this is something I deal with all day, every day in the wound clinic, okay? So the things you can change, one obviously is nutrition. Okay, if you're on a high carb diet, that doesn't help. If you're diabetic and you're taking in, you know, 3 or 4 Cokes a day, and you're having, you know, your mashed potatoes and gravy and steak, that wound is not going to do real well because your sugar levels are going to be sky high. I tell my patients, when I meet a diabetic patient for the first time, there's a measure, it's called A1C. And if their A1C is like 12 or 13, I like it under 7. And I tell them, if you want to be my patient, you got to get that A1C down to 7. Or else you're just going to have nothing but problems. And so nutrition, especially if you're a diabetic. Hygiene, obviously. We'll talk a little bit about that too with what happened in Haiti. And then obviously, you know, blood flow. Some people just don't have great blood flow, especially down to the lower extremities. Obesity, smoking is obvious, alcoholism, a lot of the what goes on there is the liver produces a lot of the healing factors, and someone with alcoholism, they don't have a great liver typically. And then exercise is also important. Now there are things you can't change, you know, your age, genetics, and then some people have antibiotic resistance, and then there are conditions where, you know, HIV, where your immune system is just suppressed. And again, that kind of goes in with diabetes. Diabetes is typically genetic, and patients with diabetes, their immune system becomes compromised, especially if their sugars are running high for a long time, and then that just wipes out a lot of the normal healing factors. So this is just a little graph, I won't really go into that, but basically, you know, you get a cut, and then the first thing that happens is hemostasis. So little signals come out, a blood clot is formed to seal off the area, because our bodies are amazing. They are so amazing. And, you know, Heavenly Father set this off so that if we did get an injury, then our body would try to cover that, because what's in outside, the external factors, we need to keep out of the wounds. And so there's a number of different things that go on. It's an amazing, but this would take 25 minutes to go through all that for you. But there are phases. So you have the immediate phase where you start with the clot formation. And then in 5 to 7 days, you have this proliferative phase. And this is that granulation. So when you see a wound and it looks like a just really good beef steak, that's what we're looking for. We want that really red tissue. Because that's in the proliferative stage, and then it'll go through the remodeling stage a lot quicker. What we don't like to see are wounds that are black, or, you know, green, or kind of that grayish. That's going to take a while to get to this stage because it's not going through the proliferative phase at the right time. So this shows you here. So primary intention, you get a cut, you go to the emergency room or emergent care center, and they clean it, they put a stitch in, and you have a little scar. Okay. Secondary intention, and that's a lot of what I deal with diabetic wounds, is they get a wound, it's usually a pressure wound, and it opens up, so they have fat exposed, and so you have to wait for this to fill in from up, and it usually leaves a large scar. And then there's also one where you can go in and cut out a wound and close it. That doesn't work very well on the bottom of the foot. So these are the things. What we're going to see mostly here is the secondary with the things that I saw in Haiti. Again, there's different types. Again, this doesn't really apply. This is more for the home health nurses that we lecture to. But there are different types of wounds.
some that are caused by pressure, so you know bed sores, okay, that's a pressure injury. Venous stasis, that's people, as time goes on, your veins stop working, you get a lot of swelling in your legs, and then you, that ends up causing the skin to break down. You'll see some pictures of that. Arterial, that means there's no blood flow, so the skin dies, and those are the ones that are usually black. You hear gangrene, the term gangrene, it's usually related to someone that has insufficient blood flow. And then we have the diabetic ulcers, the neuropathic. What that means is they have no sensation. They've lost the sensation to the bottoms of their feet. You know, they walk around. I had a, in residency, I'll never forget this guy. He was a character. He comes in and he's like, oh, I'm here because my wife, she says, I smell. And we took his shoe off and he had a hole that big right in the ball of his foot. And you look in the shoe and there's a screw, a grabber screw. Like an inch and a half grabber screw. This has been going on for who knows how long. And the infection was in the ball and we had to take the end of his foot off. But that's what neuropathy means nerve damage. And so they get these wounds, they walk on it, and if they're not checking their feet, you know, it just amazes me that people don't look at their feet. You know, I look at mine, maybe it's because it's what I do, but I mean, I check mine every day, but. So that's one thing I tell my dad, you got to check your feet, because you could, another patient of mine, she likes to swim, and one day she gets to her car, she's done swimming, and she doesn't have her car keys. And she's like, where are my keys? And she searches all around, and she goes to the locker, they're not in the locker, and she's like, oh yeah, I think I put them into my shoe. She takes off her shoe, and there's her car keys. You know, that's what neuropathy, that's what the diabetics, that's a challenge that they're up with. So, and then there's wounds that, you know, get infected, open up, and then there's some of these other strange things that we see quite often. So this is what I saw in Haiti. Again, those of you who are late, some of these are graphic, so I apologize, but this is what I had to deal with. This particular was a 17-year-old girl, okay? This is her foot, and this is her ankle bone coming out. Now the sad thing here is if this had happened here, I don't think we would have had to amputate her leg. But this is 10 days out, it's totally infected, I don't have a wound vac, I don't have antibiotics to give her, so we had to amputate her leg. And you know, again, this is a crush injury. She had a beam land on her foot and popped out. But I can tell you, if they had just taken some good old soap and water, wash this and just try to pop it back in, they probably could have got it back in and then immobilize it, we wouldn't have had to amputate this poor girl's leg. So these are the things that we had to deal with. Some of these people were out in the sticks and they had to come in.
You just said something. If they had to clean it out and try to pop it back in, it might have saved her leg. We're trained to not try and do something.
I understand that, but in a situation, okay, and hopefully you never have to do this, but some of the points I'm going to talk about, even if you clean this out and wrap it up and protect it, okay, even if you do that, there's a very good chance we wouldn't have had. But leaving it open to the environment like this, there's just no chance to save that.
So, what I understand what you want to say is that if the it won't heal because it's out of place, and if it heals, it will be out of there. I remember one day I woke up and I was walking weird, and then but I could walk, but I couldn't put the weight on my leg, and then I just knew there was something weird. So I went to the doctor, and she happened to be and she told me, this bone is out of place, and she just went like this, and she pushed it back. So that's where did this happen?
This is in Haiti. So 10 years ago, well, almost 10 years, it's been 8 years ago, 2010. I served my mission in Haiti, for those that came in late, and so after the earthquake, I went down with some of my old companions. There's 5 of us that are physicians, and we all served our missions together, and we went down after the earthquake to help out. So, but yeah, my point here, and we'll talk about this, And, you know, maybe they didn't feel like popping it in, and that's fine. But if they had washed this and cleaned it regularly and protected it, okay, then there's a good chance she'd still have her ankle. Because see all this? This is just dead tissue. It's been stretched out. The blood vessels have, you know, been ruptured. It's not getting any blood flow. And if I'd had a wound back and antibiotics in a place that I could, and an external fixator that I could have put on her, I could have saved her life. But I didn't have any of that stuff. So.
Stan, how long would a wound vac have to sit on that to try and clean it out?
Well, probably 3 months.
So you just leave it on all the time? They walk around with it? It's portable?
No, you don't walk. When you have something like this, you don't walk on it. It is portable. Yeah. It's a portable device.
So it's attached to them and they'd be mobile and they just carry it around for 3 months?
Yeah. That's why this event was so traumatic for me, because I deal with stuff like this and I save feet all the time. And I couldn't save these feet because I didn't have the resources that we normally have. And so this was really eye-opening for me, and I learned a lot from this, that things that we can do, the simple things that we can do to help our, you know, our loved ones or even ourselves, so we don't end up with a below knee amputation. Open fracture, crush injuries, large abrasions, so, you know, just blocks falling down and just skinning, you know, taking all the skin off. Hematomas, people would come in with big, you know, blood blisters that we'd drain, or they'd have bruises and we had to cut the skin open and evacuate the hematoma, get all that blood out. Blood is like a milkshake for bacteria, right? It just, when you get a hematoma, if it gets a little bacteria, it's, you know, now you've got a huge area of infection. So, and then even some of the wounds that we did, some of the legs that we amputated, you know, some of them would open up and we had to deal with that. And then degloving injuries. You know, degloving is just where essentially it just takes the skin, the fat, tendons, and you just kind of have all. And we saw those. And again, some of these are graphic and you'll see an example of that. So these are just some of the things. See this poor kid, he got his hand stuck under a block. And the only way he was getting out was he just, you know, they had the pole. So you can see here's his metacarpals right here sticking out. But see this red tissue? This is good. So we had to cut off the rest of the bones there. But, you know, he doesn't have much. He has a thumb. So... And this poor lady, same thing, her hand, she was an older lady, the block just fell on her fingers and they were so swollen that no blood flow could get out and they had to amputate her fingers. This is another, you know, injury there on top of the foot. But these were good, and this is stuff that we saw, and you don't need a wound vac for this, and we'll talk about that. Good old wet to dry dressings will take care of this. And that's what we taught a lot of the Haitians down there. We taught them how to do this basic wound care. And they got really good at it. So again, you know, thing we look at, the type of wounds, and then we come up. This is kind of what we do as physicians and the nursing staff, is there are different types of wound, and we kind of have these little protocols that we like to start with. This is a diabetic right here. Had a little too much fun out on the sand, out on the hot sand, so third degree burn on the bottom of their foot because they didn't realize how hot it was. Campfires, you would be amazed at how many people come in to see me because of burns to the bottom of their feet because they put their feet out, you know, to warm them up over the campfire. Because they have lost the sensation. And yeah, I see a lot of black toes because of campfires. So, there's an acronym we use, DIMES. You don't really need to remember that. But these are the things, basic wound care, you know, debridement. That, we'll talk a lot about that. Infection. Again, in an emergency situation, we're not going to be able to have, you know, antibiotics. It's going to be difficult. But here, it'll be easier to access antibiotics than in Haiti. And then a moist wound always heals best. Okay? I always get tired. Everybody's, oh, it needs air. It needs air. No, it needs to be moist and protected. Okay, the air—that's where everything is. So protect it, please. And then the edge, the wound edges, if it gets too moist, then the wound edges can break down. And there's a lot of different things that we do. It's really become a pretty sophisticated wound care house. And I'm not going to go into all those. We're just going to the basics. Again, you can see, you know, she just, a lot of debris fell on her head, and she just had a lot of these abrasions. So this, here's where we talk about the things that I learned, okay? Cleanse. Soap and water can go a long ways. All right, so it's important.
Hand soap, dish soap?
Yeah, I don't care. Any soap, yeah. Yeah, hand soap. My favorite stuff, everybody had a bottle of this in your bathroom or kitchen, wherever you keep your emergency supplies.
What is it?
HibaCleanse. This stuff is awesome, okay? HibiCleanse. HibaCleanse, it's kind of a pink. I love the smell of it too. It's kind of a weird thing, but I'll just pass it around. The HibaCleanse, it's very, most people don't have too many sensitivities to it, and I just pour it right on wounds, and it's great. It'll clean, it gets rid of the bacteria count. The other thing that's always good is betadine is good too, but some people have allergies to iodine, so you kind of have to be a little more careful with this. You don't use betadine quite as much anymore. But HibaCleanse is awesome. But again, soap and water. If you don't have soap, that's fine. You know, water, clean water. So that's why it's important in an emergency situation that we have clean water available.
And you mentioned antibiotics. Is there a way to get antibiotics to put in your emergency kits?
I can. I can for me.
But we're just common folk, so how do we get it?
I don't know.
I was wondering, you know, I do herbs, and I was thinking, what do you do in case there's nothing else? And I made a tincture of oregano and cloves, and I understand that it kills everything, so I don't know if that would be a good substitute in case of something.
Oh, yeah. When we talked about that at the first of the lecture, you know, in primitive times, there's all kinds of remedies out there. And I don't have an issue with them. You know, the other day, this gentleman, he has a wound. It's taken a while to get better. He came in with his tube of hemorrhoid cream. And he says, this helps everything. I've used this for years. Will you put it on there? I'm like, you know, whatever. Patients know best, right? So, yeah, I put his hemorrhoid cream on his wound. I don't know. We'll see in 2 weeks if it is magical. But, yeah, a lot of those things do no harm. And if you don't have, you know, access. But that's why it would be good if you purchase, you know, some antibiotic ointment and some HibaCleanse.
Just keep Neosporin.
Yeah, Neosporin is good. Some people have sensitivities to Neosporin. There's something better that I like. We'll talk about that. But I'm telling you, soap and water, okay? I'm trying to make this really simple for you. Even the antibiotics part of it. Soap and water will probably go further with any wound, especially if you catch it acute. Now the antibiotics, like for that, you know, for this is 8 weeks out, or not 8 weeks, 8 days out. It would be nice if I had some IV antibiotics to give her, okay? But I didn't. But even if we clean this with soap and water, so you can see how nasty all this bandage is. They tried, okay? I give them credit. They tried. They wrapped it. They at least protected it. Some people were coming in with just open wounds that had been exposed for 7 or 8 days. But you clean it and then protect it. Okay, we need to protect from the environment, control the bleeding, and then the things that help debride are the wet to moist dressings. And we'll talk about that. Again, the wound vacuum, this slide is kind of for, not just for Haiti, it's one that we use for home health. And in the emergency situation, you're not going to have a wound vac available. But the wet to moist do a great job. You need to control the swelling. That's why you should have 2 ACE wraps for every individual in your family. Okay? You should have these ACE wraps on hand. Because these are lifesavers. This provides compression, but also the easiest way to keep something on a body part is to wrap it on with an ACE wrap. Thank you. And then, obviously, casting and splinting, you know, people would come in. It was eye-opening to see how, you know, innovative they were with what they had to splint. In fact, we had patients coming in, their family would carry them in, and they took the door off their home, and they converted into a gurney to pack them in. So they're very resourceful with what they, you know, what little they had. So this lady did okay, actually. We didn't have to amputate her leg. It was mostly superficial. She had almost a compartment syndrome. We had to open it up, drain out some of the pus, and start the wet to dry dressing. What the wet to dry is, you take a saline, and you take a gauze, you get it kind of moist, and then you pack it in the wound. You cover it up with another dressing, and then you do this twice a day. As that dries, kind of the dead particles will dry and cake onto the gauze. So what you do is you pull that. It's very painful for the patient, but you pull that, and that pulls off the dead tissue, and it gets us to that proliferative phase, that granulation tissue. That's the best way to get to granulation tissue, is doing the wet to dry dressings. And that's what I was teaching. There were just hundreds of these young, you know, 20, 25-year-old Haitians, and I'm like, hey, come here. This is what you do, and you're going to do this twice a day, every day. And it works. It works great. And so that's why I say you have to have plenty of water on hand, have some gauze, and you'll be able to avoid a lot of these devastating injuries that ended up with the bologna amputations. So this gentleman, he came in. Again, they tried. Okay, they did wrap it. They tried to protect it. He had a block land right on his leg. I don't have the x-ray, but he just smashed his tibia and fibula. They were smashed. Again, if I had an external fixator, I could have put that external fixator on there. And if I had antibiotics, IV antibiotics, I could have washed this out. And a wound vac, I could have saved his leg. But I didn't have any of that. He was HIV positive. His immune system, this was, you know, he was really sick. He had real high fever, and so to save his life, we had to amputate his leg. And so without, you know, washing this out, soap and water, and protecting it, that's when you start getting tissue will die. And what happens when you leave meat in the outside after it sits out in the sun after a day or two? What happens to it? It rots, right? It's nasty. Well, why? Why does it smell? Yeah, bacteria is having a party, okay? Bacteria is what smells. So same thing, if you have necrosis, you have dead tissue, it's going to start smelling, and the bacteria counts get higher. And then if you get too much swelling, then you're not getting as much blood flow, so then you just get more necrosis and more dead tissue, more area for the bacteria to live on. And then the infection and compartment syndrome, that's where you get so much swelling that it cuts off the blood flow to that body part.
I have a question about saline. I have some, but I don't know. I think there is different kinds of saline.
Usually the typical is the 0.9% saline is usually. They also have sterile water too. Sterile water is great. But the water here is good, you know, your tap water would be fine, seriously. Tap water, just wash it, yeah. Now, in an emergency, we may not have water, though, right?
That's why you carry those.
You carry that, or just water, you know, in your supply. You should have a supply of water. Because it's really valuable. Water is so valuable to wound care. So one of the reasons we had to do a lot of amputations is they just didn't know that they needed to clean these wounds and go through these steps. There was no protection. A lot of them came in that they were just wrapped in kind of like a blanket. It wasn't sterile gauze. They didn't have ACE wraps. The swelling had got out of control. Again, antibiotics were scarce. And then, you know, this gentleman had broke his tibia and fibula. Yeah, we didn't have an external fixer, we didn't have rods to put down his leg. And so this is Chuck, he was my companion on my mission. He's a sports medicine doctor. down in Arizona, and he's tugging on the leg, holding the reduction while we wrap the leg with plaster to maintain it.
So is fixation just like getting it stable, kind of like a splint or something?
Yeah, so fixation is actually how you hold it back in place.
Okay.
So putting it back in place is called reduction. Okay. And so typically, you know, in the operating room, I do a lot of open reduction. So I open, put it in place, internal fixation. That's the preferred, because then you wash it out and it's primary closure, you close it up. But something like this, you know, we don't have any type of plates, we don't have external fixators. Those are those big frames you see people with the pins, you know, and you can hold things in place. So we just had to do the good old cast, which worked, you know, it's worked in the past. But the downside with the cast is you have to change it multiple times. There's more chance of non-union of the bone, and they're messy. So again, the debridement, you know, sharp debridement. This is what I do, a lot of sharp debridement on the wounds that I deal with, and that's where you're using a scalpel or you're using, you know, devices that clear off the dead tissue or the non-viable tissue and get it so we can get that red tissue. And then there are also autolytic debridement. Those are just dressings, and they kind of help soften and promote the production of granulation tissue. This is something that, if there's something you want to have in your first aid kit, Neosporin's great. This is a little more expensive. It's MetaHoney. Okay? And I used to kind of laugh at this stuff when I first saw it in the journals, but I love this stuff, MetaHoney. Honey is amazing. Again, we can get wounds to this granulation tissue stage a lot quicker with the honey. It provides a moist barrier, and it helps soften some of that fibrous portion of the wound, and it's also antimicrobial because of the high glucose level.
So is that just honey or a medical honey?
It's a medical honey, yeah. Supposedly these bees in New Zealand are better than any other bees. And so again, here's another one of those. If I had known, or if I had even, I wasn't so.
That's what I heard.
I should have invested in this company too. Yeah.
Yes. Like
heal,
so it's true.
Yes.
Because I was told that I take vinegar with chani, and I don't like anything super sweet. But that's what they told me, that the chani has some effect of healing whatever you have in
there. Yeah, you could use vinegar for a one time just to wash it out, clean it, okay? But then stick with honey. Yeah, the high glucose bacteria can't survive, and honey is great. MetaHoney. So this is over the counter, getting on Amazon, and I love it.
I was going to ask you, whenever my daughter had a burn, and then I told him to put aloe vera, but then he told him to put some germs and stuff, and then to cover. But I told him, no, I put aloe vera again, that will kill everything, but I don't know if that's the right.
Aloe vera is fine if it's just a first or second degree. If it's a burn and you get black, you know, the black, then MetaHoney or Silvadine. Silvadine's a prescription. That's what I love about MetaHoney, you can get it. It's not, you don't need a prescription for this. Yeah,
so
looks
when
great.
You talk about the black, is the black skin and the black spot, because that's what she got, kind of optimized.
Yeah, if you have black, that means it's a full thickness burn. And so and so it's gonna take a while to heal. Yeah. That'll take a long time. But MetaHoney will keep it from getting infected, and it'll soften up that black tissue so that you can get it down to the red base.
Like a silver ointment.
Yeah, silver is good too. Silver kills bacteria. There's silver, Silvazorb. There's a number of different products out there with silver. And I like silver too. But MetaHoney's been my go-to. This in the wound clinic all the time, and like this Santil, this is like $280 a tube. You get this for 12, or well, a bigger one than this. This is like 8, but the bigger one is like $12 or $14, and it's so much better than this stuff. But so debridement is a real important part of wound care. We got to get the dead tissue off because bacteria loves to live on it, and we need to stimulate the wound. And the only way to stimulate it is to get the dead tissue off. This one's pretty graphic. I apologize, but this shows. So you see all this is just this yellow, fibrous, you know, and it's kind of smelly. And poor girl, it was just this was a hard one for us, but. We kind of got a block on her, but essentially she just, I mean, this is like being skinned alive, right? Mm-hmm. You see, we had to use a scalpel and just clear all of this stuff off. But I'll tell you, within 3 days, she almost had new skin again. Yeah, because you got to get it to this stage. See this red stuff? That's where the healing factors are. This is just stagnant. It's just, so... This is sharp debridement is very important with wound care. So.
And then what do you do? Do you apply anything that helps?
Yeah. So then you apply, this adaptive with stuff that we use. So it's a non-adherent; it doesn't stick. And we didn't have honey back in these days, but just a non-adherent, and then protect it with a wrap. And kids do great. They heal fast.
But if you just have honey in your house and then you would apply, would that be the same?
Yeah, I think it's okay. But, I mean, in the wound clinic, we can't really just use regular honey. But the meta honey. This doesn't taste as good as regular honey either.
We tried it.
Yeah, we tried it. So, anyway, so that's kind of the end of my experience in Haiti. Just to kind of wrap that up, soap and water is your best friend. Okay, you gotta, if you're in an emergency situation, you gotta clean it, get the contaminants out, and then protect it. Okay, you can protect it with Neosporin. If you have some of these non-adherent, you know, gauze, adaptive, Xeroform. I love Xeroform. It's kind of the yellow impregnated gauze, and put that on. Acts as a barrier, keeps it so it doesn't stick, and protect it. If it's an open fracture, yeah, obviously, maybe you don't want to try to reduce it too much, but clean it out, wrap it, protect it, keep bacteria from getting in there. And the wet to dry dressings they're amazing. They're painful, but it's amazing to get wounds to heal. So, and just those simple things, that's what I taught my friends in Haiti, and we turned just regular young kids into great wound care specialists in those short time that we were there. And when we went back 6 months later, you know, we heard the stories, and it was amazing how they, you know, they stuck with it and they took care of those patients, because we were just there for a short time, and they're the ones that did the long term wound care. And we went back, and 6 months later, and there's all these people, you know, cruising around with one foot in their crutches, and they were happy just to be alive. So, any questions on that then? The rest of this is more directed, just kind of the wounds that I see in the clinic. Pressure injuries, these are like bed sores, you know. So, this might apply to some of your family members. You know, if they're complaining on the back of their heel or their elbow or their tail end, they have a little red spot. It tells you that they're laying in one position too much. And so stage one, you know, you see the little red. And the key thing here is to protect it. Get them off of it. Stage two, you know, that's when it causes some damage to the top layer of the skin. Again, these are treated pretty easily with debridement and dressing. Now stage three, that's when they're getting down. You see, here's the bone, you know, and here's the fat. So it gets down through the two layers of skin, it's into the fat. And these are the ones that can get infected really quick, and they take a long time to get better. You know, this happens because someone is constantly on their backside, or their heels are constantly touching something, or they're constantly just... They're just sitting in wheelchairs, and their heels are just, you know, the weight of their legs are just constantly compressing, and there's no blood flow. And these are really difficult to get better. A lot of wound vacs, sometimes we do skin grafts, and then these are the ones where it gets down to the bone. You can see here's some bone. And once the bone gets infected, then you're really in trouble, and we usually have to do partial amputations or go in and take out the bone. So that's pressure sores.
So stay on that last picture. The second one down is a heel.
Yeah, this
What's
is
the bottom
heel?
One.
This is a tail end, someone's backside.
You mean like the backside?
Yeah, yeah. So right here where your tailbone is, that's a common area for bed sores.
Yeah.
And so your ischials are the other ones that people would get them. I don't treat those. I just treat the foot and the ankle stuff, but we have them in the wound clinic all the time. It's really sad. So, again, a lot of this is for the home health nurses. But these are some things, you know, these are pressure sores. And you might see this, you know, in one of your, you know, your parents or, you know, they're laying on their backside all the time and no blood flow. What happens? It dies. And so, usually if something's really black and shiny like this, I just leave it alone. Just have them protected is all. And then eventually it'll start to see the edges here. This one we actually got better, believe it or not. But see how the granulation tissue, and they'll come in every week and I'll trim off anything that wants to lift off, and we'll get some of that red tissue going, and we get those better.
Is that the knee?
This?
Uh-huh.
No, this is the bottom of the heel.
Oh.
So they're always laying like that. So, mostly older patients, but we'll see these in drug addicts. They'll pass out and they'll be on their back for, you know, hours or days, and they wake up and they have these big sores on the back of their heels, elbows, tailbone. You have a question?
One of the lessons from all this is not just how to treat people, but how to prevent.
Yeah.
If we've got people, ourselves or our families, who are in a nursing home or any of these conditions where they're like that, they need to be moved around and changed and be aware of this.
Yeah, so I had a patient, and he had this wound on the inside of his heel, and it was driving me crazy. I worked on this, I got it better, and it came back really quick. And I went like 6 months, and I just could not get this wound better. And I know I had talked to him about this before. I said, so do you sleep, you know, because the wound's on his left. Do you sleep on your right side? He's like, well, yeah, I have to because my wife, you know, the way our bed's set up, I have to sleep that way. And I'm like, well, is there any way you could rotate the other way? He's like, oh, my wife's not going to like that. She's going to have to switch sides of the bed. And I said, well, can you try it? And I'm not kidding you. Within 2 weeks, that wound was better. Because every night he would sleep on that same side, and so the weight of his leg would push the inside part of his heel in the mattress, and would get blood supply, and it just. But he switched sides, and within 2 weeks the wound was healed. His wife doesn't like me too much, but she's getting over it because now she's had to change her habits. Yeah, maybe she'll get a wound on hers. But no, it's funny though, some of the habits, and you know. You have to kind of kick some of these habits sometimes. And then if you have a patient that has diabetes and they don't feel pain, they have these wounds, but it's not painful, it's hard to convince them that they just need to get off that foot. Because it doesn't hurt. It must be fine. So here's another problem I see a lot of, okay? Again, this really is an emergency preparedness, but I just figure while you're here, I'll give you just some basic wound care. If you have family members, you know, that have these dark legs like this, this is a vein problem. And so their veins, instead of, you know, pushing the blood up, they're incompetent and the blood flow just goes down, their legs fill up, and that causes a lot of tension in the tissues, the little blood vessels pop, and they get these nasty wounds on their legs. And you can see, look at that skin, it's just all unhealthy. So we have to do a lot of compression wraps to get these better. I see a lot of these all day, every day. again, edema, if you get, the more edema you get, it just acts as a tourniquet and you get less blood flow to those areas.
So that bottom right one, to make it so it doesn't get to the bottom left, what do you do?
Oh, compression stockings. Yeah, so this patient, see, they've had this before, and this is better.
Oh,
okay. Cool. I know that looks, that might look bad to you, but that's much better than this. So this is before, and this is the after. We got them healed. But that patient has to wear compression stockings all the time. Okay. If they don't, they're going to end up with this again. And you'll be amazed at how many we get them better, and 5 months later, they're back in the wound clinic, starting with the whole thing all over again. So exercise is really important to keep your, you know, your veins in shape. It's really important that you exercise. So again, this is just the same thing. These wounds, lymphedema, you know, that's something that's usually, it's more of a genetic thing, but you know, it's same thing. These legs get like this. You get these big wounds. All these little bones pop open, and it's just a sad thing that. We see.
What do you do for that?
That one is a tough one because it is a lymphedema. It's not. There's not a lot you can do other than well, it tells you right here: lymphedema, massage, and light compression. You would think you would do tight compression, but you actually do light compression. So the ones, these others, that's where we, you know, we do compression. These two or four layer wraps. They're very helpful. We use a lot of those in the wound, the wounds better. And then once they're done, then they stay in their stockings. There's like lymphedema clinics, and that's all they do is teach them how to deal with it. And these are some of the, you know, stockings. A lot of the lymphedema people have to wear these full body edema suits.
So what does that do? Is that the blood doesn't go all over? Or?
Yeah, it helps compress it, bring it back up.
To bring it back, so it's kind of like making a tube, whatever, that makes it better.
Yeah, because the valves aren't working, and so you just have to support it externally the best you can. Gravity, I mean, gravity is just not our friend, right? And gravity, it works on us all day, every day. We are fighting gravity. And so some of us are equipped a little better than others. So these are just some diabetic foot wounds, you know, that we take care of. For example, something like this. This will probably take 4 to 6 months to get that patient better. And these are some different things that we use. Again, this is if someone has poor blood flow. You know, where are you going to see it the most in the toes, right? Because that's kind of the end of the line. So if you're not getting blood flow out there, the tissue dies, and you get these little wounds. And those are very difficult. My favorite friend is the vascular surgeon. He makes me look good. If there is a way to get blood flow. So sometimes there's blockage up there and they can go in and put stents in, and it's amazing because it makes my job easier because the wounds get better almost within 2 or 3 weeks. Yes?
You know, on that last slide you showed get rid of calluses?
Yeah.
Callus removal?
Yeah. So this here, this started because of a big callus. The patient has no sensation and they just walk on that callus. That's like walking on a rock. Mm-hmm. And it just erodes the entire full thickness.
So get rid of the callus and it'll prevent?
Yeah, you keep calluses trimmed down. Yeah. So I have patients come see me and I just trim their calluses periodically so they can avoid that. So a lot of the preventative stuff we do. Again, this is, you know, no blood flow. What's going to happen here is these will eventually just kind of dry up, and a lot of that will fall off. We'll probably have to amputate. But the problem is you amputate here, and then that doesn't heal, and you amputate here, that doesn't heal, and then you eventually take off the leg. So some of the patients, you know, they have abdominal surgery, it doesn't go well, and the wound pops open. Here you can see a plate down in the foot, just staring at you. You don't like to see that. But again, wound vacuums help with this significantly. And this is just, as we get older, our skin can get really frail, and we'll we'll have patients come in the wound clinic, they just have these, the skin just kind of peels off. And those you do pretty well.
What does a vacuum do? Does it just do like the vacuum what we do?
Yeah, so it pulls the blood flow out to the wound, and it also gets rid of any drainage and bacteria or exudate. Yes.
That can, like, we get with vacuums?
No.
You
can. You don't want one, but yeah, you come to the wound clinic, and you know that's where you get
it. Yeah.
I don't know. I haven't looked on eBay. It might be out there. But usually, you get a wound back. It's rented to you by the company, and then you have to give it back. So.
You can own one.
Not that I'm aware of. So I don't have one.
So then who can own them? Who are
they? Typically, well, it's the company that rents them to the patients through their insurance company, or you can self-pay, but it's about $860 a week to rent one. And then putting them on, that's not easy. So, and that's why I like working in the wound clinic, because I don't put them on, the nurses put them on for me. Because they're time-consuming. Because you have to get a seal so that you're not pulling in air from the outside. If you don't get a seal, then it defeats the whole purpose. So back to hematomas. So here's this will just kind of walk you through. Here's this not very healthy, and they had blunt trauma, and they were just wrapping it, not getting any better. So this is where, you know what, we got to surgically debride it. Okay, so numb them up. And I cut out, get rid of all the dead stuff, and then we get to this layer. That looks good. Maybe to you guys that's gross, but it looks good to me. And now we start with a wound vac. Okay, so the wound vac, there'll be a piece of black foam that goes on here, and then the wound vac tube will go on, and then they get a seal, and then over a period of time, it goes to this. And see how deep it is? Look how the wound comes up to the surface. And see here, it's right on the surface, there's just a little bit. And I clean that every time they come in. I clean off any of that biofilm and stimulate the wound. And, oh, I thought we had to find them. Anyway, yeah, that once you get the wound back, this goes pretty quick for wound care. Some people think 3 months is a long time, but that's actually pretty good for wounds if you can get them better within 3 months. There's all kinds of products out there. I tell my patients all the time, because everybody has their go-to or their favorite. You know, there's silver, there's honey, there's the Santil, there's Prisma. This is a collagen base. There's all these products. I have reps come in my office every day. Well, this is all, look, the doctors, they're getting such amazing results with this, okay? The bottom line is, the most important thing to a wound, that you can do to a wound, is what you take off the wound, not what you put on the wound. It is important to protect the wound, but the most important thing is what you take off the wound. So any contamination, any dead stuff, it's got to come off. You got to wash it out. I don't expect you guys to do debridements, but that's my job. I do debridements, I get the dead stuff off, and then if a patient has diabetes and they have a wound on the bottom of the foot, how is that wound going to get better if they're walking on it? It won't. It never will. Okay? So, if you have a bed sore, how is that wound going to get better if you keep laying on that sore? It won't. You have to keep the pressure off. So the most important thing is what you don't put on the wound, and that's pressure. And also taking the stuff off the wound. This is just a gross one. They use maggots sometimes. I don't see the big benefit in that. This again is just, this was kind of for the nurses. And then we do skin grafts. You know, there's synthetic skin grafts, and then I like regular skin grafts because they work the best. But there's all different, again, there's a bunch of different things. But the most important thing is getting it to this stage, then you can put skin graft on it and get it better quicker. So these are, you know, just in closing, you know, here, it's just, beautiful girl, what she had on her hands. Every morning, we'd get up and have a morning site, read the scriptures, have a couple spiritual thoughts, and then we'd go off and do our thing. And so, just amazing people. I've been through a lot, and I was just glad that I could help out a little bit. I don't know that I did a lot, but it did so much for me, and it really helped me understand wound care even better, and just the basics. So, any questions? Yes.
What did your feeling of Great Clock? I'm in the mountains.
Yep.
Hunting camp a lot.
Yep. If it's a bad leader, you better. Yes.
Okay. How is it easy? I mean, you gotta cut. You open it up, put good clot in, and stop bleeding.
Yes.
Is how easy does that come out? I'm just not that it matters to me, but I'm just curious. How
it comes out pretty easily.
Yeah. That's.
Yep. Yeah. You gotta control bleeding. Absolutely. Right. You gotta control bleeding. You know, if cleaning it is, you know, if you're between washing it out really good or bleeding, you better just control the bleeding.
Yeah.
But if it's, you know, if it's bleeding but it's not a major artery, then wash it out good. Wrap it up. Compression, ACE wraps work great. These are good. You know, these abdominal pads. They really absorb a lot. So these are some basic things you should have around the house. Some abdominal pads, some gauze, you know, non-stick stuff, and just make sure, and Perlex. Just a quick story. I took a full big duffel bag, one of those Cabela's big duffel bags, full of this Perlex. And we never ran out, but I don't know how we didn't run out. Because I'd reach in that bag, and I swear I took the last one. And every time I'd reach in that bag, there was more Curlex. So Curlex kind of has a special, anytime I put Curlex on, it kind of reminds me of Haiti. But yeah, this stuff,
it's what is the use for that?
Just to roll on for arms, heads, anywhere.
Just kind of a wrap.
Yeah. If you have a big open wound, you can just take this and stuff it in, you know, pack it to stop the bleeding. So it's just a roll of gauze, a big roll. So.
Hey, Sam?
Yes.
So, for us lay people, where's the, I guess, best place to get these kind of supplies?
I would probably get them on Amazon.
That's
probably the cheapest place, yeah. I mean, you go to Walmart, or Walgreens, but a lot of these things are expensive. So, and there's Intermountain Home Health, they have, but they're kind of expensive too. So I would look for most of it on Amazon. I know one year they would buy a bunch of supplies for everybody, and they bought them through my office. And it kind of gave my office manager heartburn, but we did it.
Yes. You know, like colored wrap that they sometimes will
put. Oh, yeah, Colbert.
Yeah, I sometimes get that at IFA.
Yeah.
Because they use it for horses to wrapping. Yeah. It's cheaper to buy the horse wrap than the human wrap.
Yes.
It's the same stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, go to IFA. Don't buy this stuff at Walmart or Walgreens because it's three times as much. And the vet wrap, the 3M, that's the 3M brand. It's the best stuff. And it's the same stuff. So, yeah. The 6-inch rolls of vet wrap at IFA were great. Yeah, you should have lots of rolls of that on hand, too. So, anyway, that's all I had today.
Fantastic.
Hopefully we don't have a disaster like this.